Dear friends watching us tonight, good evening. Good evening. Greetings from Mwanza on the lake shore of Victoria. We greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. We've been receiving reports of encouraging from various downlinks around Africa and other places. Praise be to God. Friend, have you brought someone tonight? Maybe there's someone beside you. Why don't you reach out and hold his hand, shake his hand, shake your neighbor, and get to know him and her as we share the experience of listening to the word of God tonight. God is good all the time. Tonight I want to mention a few places of interest. One of them is Congo North, 350 people in attendance. In Goma Central Church, 150 people in Beroya Church. Pastor K. Msema, are you there watching us tonight? We want you to know we are with you tonight. Keep up the good work you have done. Lesotho, south of Africa, although bitterly cold, still people are watching and attending satellite meetings with heaters to warm themselves. Thank you, Sister Jane, for the fax message which you sent to us. We received it. Welcome as you join Sister satellites around the globe. Tegeta Church in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. Pastor Sabuni, we hope you are there. Great things will happen there. We hope so. Ranen, Kenya, you have just started that baptism. Keep up the good spirits. May the Lord be with you. Homa Bay Central Church, Kenya, 2,000 in attendance every night. We expect a number to increase rapidly. Dear brothers and sisters, as we want to draw near to God, it is my privilege to introduce to you and present to you my sister, fellow servant in the vineyard of the Lord, Sister Mrs. Joyce Mapigano, who will lead us to the throne of grace as we stand in prayer.
Let's pray. O kumele Jesu iso yole mwigoro kuruwa voli indi na butogwa woko. Tuakoro mba seba kutuinali kanzali enele kuiza kuilanga mayo goko. Tuanaleka moyo wako mwela abize ntonge jiwise. Abana bako pie mhandine shasa hoba libilinga kwa jiri ya mayo goko kudegeleka. Tulekoro mba seba moyo wako mwela abize tawala mioyo yabo. Twantula makono gako chungaji Patzer kwa ajili ya kutina mayogoko. Bebe mwene kele untongele afunye mayogoko kubize mbegu ya wiza mioyo ya bana bako pyabose. Twalitolere kanisa lyako makono gako wizokwe Afrika, wizokwe Bulaya, wizokwe Asia na mhandine shose shase aho mayogoko gole degelekwa. Tuitola makono gako, tuanaleka moyo ngwela, abize kihamo na abize pia bose, seba hoto apungukaga, utongeje na utuine kulingana na buto goboko. Mlina lewano kwa Yesu Kristo, amen.
Yesu maisha ni mwetu, tumwinue Shilling, Manu Wawaman, Welcome this evening to Christ 2001. What a pleasure it is to come together with Jesus and talk about our best friend tonight. It's the person who knows us better than anyone else and still decides to love us anyways. Tonight we have very special guests with us, but we want to first mention one more time about our email and our fax numbers. Those churches out there in satellite land, if you feel comfortable or if you have a story that you would like to share with us, feel free to send that by fax or email, and throughout the program those will be shared throughout the night.
Tonight our special feature is going to focus on this stadium. Now many of you have not seen a picture of the stadium, and that's going to change tonight. You won't see the evening view that we have right here, but you'll see the daytime view. In the stadium are little places, and there's a ministry. There's three different ministries in the stadiums, and we're going to talk about those tonight. The first one that I'd like to talk about is the women's ministry. They have their own booth here, and with us tonight is Priscilla, and she is the director of women's ministries for the East Africa Division of Seventh-day Adventists. And we are so pleased to have her here tonight. Now, Priscilla, tell us about the booth that is right here to my left that the women's ministries of Tanzania have.
The women's ministries department in South Nyanza Conference have a women's ministries booth. And in this booth, they are selling their handicrafts so that in future they can embark on evangelistic programs.
Yes, and the things are just beautiful. I got this kitenge. Did I say that right?
Very nice.
Okay, kitenge. I purchased that over there, and there are a lot of people here that have been supporting that ministry, and they are really doing some exceptional things. Now tell us about the big event that's coming up this Thursday.
Wow, I praise the Lord. For the first time during a satellite evangelistic program, we are going to have a nurturing training program for the women. God has given a special gift to the women. They are natural nurturers. There are so many people who are baptized in our church. They come in through the front door and leave through the back door. But I want to tell you that many of these people who are converted and join the church are women and children. And so it's important to train these women to work as nurturers, especially to nurture the women. This is special feature will be uplinked on Thursday, June 28th. And I would like the entire families to come and support the women.
Yes, so it's not just for women, it's for the entire families, and we're looking forward to that. Thank you, Priscilla.
All right, Natalie, I have with me two very special gentlemen who work in their ministry with the books around here in Africa. First of all, I have Brother Barry with Kibidula Farms. Barry, tell us a little bit about some of the books that you sell here.
Darren, we're really excited to be here in Mwanza, combining forces with Tanzania Adventist Press in providing books that essentially cover the same Bible-based topics that we're hearing from night to night. And you know, it's so helpful to be able, once you hear these precious truths, to be able to buy books that you can take home and study and reinforce what you have learned. You know, we have a wide range of Kiswahili and English books and Bibles at special prices here for this effort. We have books on the life and teachings of Jesus Christ, books on Bible prophecy, Daniel and Revelation, books on the Sabbath, how to understand it, keep it, family, health, and children's books, essentially books for eternity.
Amen. Thank you, Barry. Now also with us, we have Elder Kachua, and he is with the Tanzania Adventist Press. Tell us, Elder Kachua, just a little bit about your ministry here as well.
Yes, Tanzania Adventist Press is committed for the spread of the gospel in this territory and in the countries around Tanzania, where Kiswahili is spoken as a language. We have a lot of challenges that are facing us. One of them is the supply of books. The other one is the machineries. Our machineries are getting a little bit older. Therefore, we are planning to replace them with new machineries and new technology. The Lord has been with us in the past, and we are really happy that He has promised to be leading us in the future too.
Amen. Thank you. Well, I'm sure there are books at your downlink sites as well. If you would talk to your pastor or your host there at your site, they will probably be able to hook you up with the books that you are looking for on topics similar to the speaker's topics here tonight.
And finally, Darren, our last ministry that we'd like to share with the audience, We have a medical team, and it's a neat combination of local Tanzanian doctors as well as some North American physicians also. And this evening we have Dr. Tayali with us. And Dr. Tayali, just tell us a little bit about the services offered and about how many people you are seeing per day.
Now we are seeing more than 80 patients per day, and mainly with females, males and children. And we are offering all services. We are offering preventive services. We are offering promotive services and also curative services. We are seeing a lot of people with local ailments which are preventive. So we are looking forward that we promote health by health education more in their clinic. Now we are having more than 120 patients. So we are busy, quite busy down there, yeah, sure.
Praise the Lord for the things that these people are doing in these ministries all around the stadium. And we were just so moved by it that we took some video shots, and we'd really like to show that with you, satellite audience, and just implore you to offer prayer for what's going on here in Tanzania. At the back of the stadium, the medical team treats many of the needs of the Mwanza community. American doctors and nurses work hand in hand with Tanzanian physicians.
As we circle around the stadium, we find books and resources from the Kibadula Farms and Tanzanian Adventist Publishing Associations. (laughs) 120 book titles are offered, many in the Kiswahili language. Finally, we come to a small nook in the stadium where the women's ministry team sells handcrafted apparel. These sales support their nurturing ministry to the people of Tanzania.
Thank you. Here in front, we have messengers and royal advent. But together, we are ebon and ivory.
Why don't you swing down, chair stopping, let me ride. Swing down, chair stopping, let me ride. Rock me, Lord, calm and easy. I've got a home on the other side.
Why don't you
swing down, chair stopping, let me ride. Swing down, chair stopping, let me ride. Rock me, Lord, calm and easy. I've got a home on the other side. Looked over Jordan, what did I see?
Yes, I
looked over Jordan, what did I see? A swing down chariot, a coming for me. I've got a home on the other side.
Why don't you
swing down, chest open, let me ride. Swing down, chest open, let me ride. Rock me, Lord, calm and easy. I've got a home on the other side.
Now there were
two white horses standing side by side. This old chariot's gonna let me ride one of these mornings, bright and early. I'm going home to the other side. Swing down, chariot stopping, let me ride. Swing down, chariot stopping, let me ride. Rock me, Lord, calm and easy. I've got a home on the other side.
Why don't you swing,
swing down, chariot stopping, let me ride. Swing down, chariot stopping, let me ride. Rock me, Lord, calm and easy. I've got a home on the other side. Swing down, sweet chariot stopping, let me ride.
Let's sing again the song. Let's sing again together. Let's sing the theme song together with enthusiasm. I found our way, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found our way, Jesus, He is my way to heaven. I found our way, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found our way, Jesus, He is the way to heaven. No one can stop me now, no one can stop me now, no one can stop me now, but Jesus is my way. Swahili. Tumeiona njia, njia, njia. Tumeiona njia, njia ya uzima. Tumeiona njia, njia, njia. Tumeiona njia, njia ya uzima. Hata shetani apinge, hata shetani apinge, hata shetani apinge, Yesu atahubiriwa.
Amen is right. If you don't feel warmly welcomed by now, I'm sure I can't say anything that'll make you feel more warmly welcomed. But let me try. I want to greet our many Portuguese listeners in Angola and Mozambique and Sao Tome. Let me just say to them in their language, hola, and all the rest of you, hello and God bless. Tonight's topic is just incredibly significant. I have prayed about it. We have thought about it. We've talked about it. And tonight, God is going to speak to your heart from His Word. It's not an easy topic. And I want to say right from the start that while we are going to say some things very straightforward tonight, that it in no way is to be an offense to anyone who may have a different opinion or who may be a part of some organization that we talk about this evening. We're not talking about individuals. We're talking about this great controversy between God and Satan and how there's an interplay of organizations and mankind. And so tonight, I invite you just to offer a little prayer up silently as we work our way through, and then listen very intently, because what we'll be wrestling with tonight is a topic that will mean whether or not you spend eternity with God or whether you are lost. It's the mark of the beast. I've heard all kinds of different things that people have said about the mark of the beast and what it is. I'm told that years ago, when the United States government came out with a little Social Security card number for every individual, every North American has one of these. In fact, I carry one in my wallet. That when those first came out, that people said, don't take one of those, or you're going to get the mark of the beast. I'm also told that at the time of the Second World War, when our country in America came out with rationing stamps or coupons so that some of the basics of life could be purchased when there was a shortage, that people once again said, don't take those cards. If you do, you are going to get the mark of the beast. So when we take a look at this, what is it that the scripture has to say about the mark of the beast? What is it? How does a person receive it? And tonight I want to say just right up front that I can't begin to cover all the material on this topic that's in the Bible. Particularly the first part of our presentation tonight, I'll have to go rather quickly. And so first, we're going to identify this beast of Revelation 13, and then we'll talk about the beast's mark. So get ready. Let's get started. We're going to look at a lot of texts, put them in line like we've done each night, and by the time we're finished, it's my prayer that you will clearly, clearly understand this topic. Revelation 13 talks about the beast. Has 7 heads, 10 horns. It's the basis for the rest of this sermon. This is what the scripture says about it. Revelation 13, 1 and 2. Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads, 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. And then Revelation goes on, the third verse. And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. And then verse 5, and he was given a mouth, speaking great things and blasphemies. And he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Revelation 6. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. Verse 7. It was granted him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And authority was given him over every tribe and over every tongue and over every nation. And there God lined them up, all those different points. And I'm going to give you some points and clues that will help identify that beast. But like I said, I can't take time, all the time that we need in this short series. So listen carefully tonight, because some of these descriptions will apply to different powers. See, a few years ago, some people thought that some of these would apply to the system of communism. But there's only one power that all of these descriptions fit, and that is very significant. Let me repeat. If you only select one or two of the descriptions, you can make this apply to most any civic power or church or even an individual. You only get an accurate picture of what God wants us to understand when you apply all of these points. So let's look at them. One, It says the dragon would give him his power, his seat, and his authority. Now, the dragon referred to there is the dragon in Revelation 12. You remember we studied this a few nights ago. If you go back to Revelation 12, you can identify that dragon clearly as the power of pagan Rome. Remember when we touched that when we were talking about Daniel? It says that pagan Rome would give to this beast of Revelation 13 its power, its seat, and its authority. Now that's one clue. The second clue, it says it would be a blasphemous power. It says it would speak blasphemy. Remember that word? We talked about that the other evening as well. In Josh, North Nigeria, remember? Blasphemy is when a person attributes to himself the power of God. In other words, remember when Jesus was speaking to them and he said, before Abraham was, I am, that word I am stood for God. And the people of his time when he was on earth yelled at him, blasphemy, blasphemy, because they thought that he was saying blasphemy. But he really was God, and so it wasn't blasphemy. Okay, understand? They called it blasphemy. Remember when they let the man down on the stretcher through the roof of the house to Jesus in Mark 2, 1 to 12? And he said, Jesus saying now, your sins are forgiven you. And once again, those listening said, blasphemer, you don't have the power to forgive sins. So when a person attributes to himself the power of God, that is blasphemy. And this power, this beast, is that beast, friends, of papal Rome. Now I should stop and say, we are not attacking individuals. There are many fine, conscientious Roman Catholic friends around the world who love the Lord and love God and love this word. We are talking tonight about a system, and I wouldn't want to hurt anyone in the world with what we're going to say tonight. But now look at what they say. That system, the papal power, says, we hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty. That is the Roman Catholic position. Now let's go on to clue number three. It would be a persecuting power. This power had to be some power that would persecute, and history bears out that that is exactly what that power has done down through the ages. All you have to do is go to the history books, such as Fox's Book of Martyrs, short stories of the Reformation, History of the Reformation by Dabinier, Here I Stand by Byington, History of Europe by Qualbin. All of these books line it up and tell you that this system, this organization, has persecuted. The persecution of the Huguenot people when they were killed, 60,000 of them were murdered on one Sunday morning. Millions, possibly greater than the Jewish Holocaust, were killed throughout the Dark Ages by this church system. And so history bears out that this is a fact that can't be argued. And then clue number four. It would rule for 1,260 years. That scripture makes it very clear it would rule for a definite period of time. And it ruled for exactly that period of time. Coming into power, it received its power from pagan Rome in 538. It lasted for 1,260 years to the year 1798. Exactly 1,260 years. The scripture goes on and says it would receive a deadly wound. And it received that deadly wound on February 15th, 1798, when Napoleon's general Berthier marched into Rome. This is what the American Encyclopedia says, and I quote, "In 1798, he, Berthier, made his entrance into Rome. He abolished the papal government and established a secular one." And so exactly, according to the word of God, it came to an end in 1798. Clue number six. It says the deadly wound would be healed. Well, that's an interesting twist. Received a deadly wound, all of its territory, all of its power was stripped from it, and it was reduced to that of just another church until 1929. For over 100 years, this was the Roman situation. It went back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. But in 1929, General Mussolini signed a pact which healed the deadly wound. A paper in the United States, the San Francisco Chronicle, February 11, reported it. 1929, this is what it said. "The Roman question tonight was a thing of the past, and the Vatican was at peace with Italy." Goes on, "In affixing the autographs to the memorable document, healing the wound," notice those words, "healing the wound," the same words the Bible uses, "extreme cordiality was displayed on both sides." And thus, in 1929, the Lateran Pact, as it is called, was signed, which gave back to Rome, Roman Catholicism, the right to be a sovereign government in addition to being a church. Now, folks, all I'm doing is quickly going through the points that Scripture gives to identify that power. And it says, clue seven, it would have the number 666. Okay? The Bible speaks of two classes of people, not three or four, but two classes of people. It speaks of those who receive the mark of the beast and those who receive the seal of God. It says this about them in Revelation 14, 9 and 10. "Then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast in his image and receives his mark on his forehead or in his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God." This is serious that we're talking about, friends. The wine of the wrath of God. You and I do not want to receive that. It says those people who receive the mark of the beast will receive the wrath of God. Revelation 13, 16, 7 goes on. "He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or in their foreheads, that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name." So it says that the people who receive the mark of the beast, they will receive this mark. Those that don't will not be able to buy or sell. So you're going to be faced with a serious question tonight, friends. Most serious question that could be posed from God's word. You have to decide which you prefer. Do you want the wrath of God? Because those who receive the mark of the beast will receive the wrath of God. Or do you want the wrath of men? Now, I don't know about you, I don't really care for either of those. But as far as I'm concerned, if I have to choose, I'll take the wrath of men, not the wrath of God. You see, those that have the seal of God, it says this about them. We talked about that seal of God the other night. Remember, it was the seventh-day Sabbath, that seal that sanctified that relationship between God and man. Revelation 7, 2 and 3 said, "Then I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried in a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, Do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads." So where is this mark of the beast received? On the forehead or on the right hand? And the seal of God is received where? On the forehead. It talks about both of them being received in the same place. But these people that receive the seal of God, it says in Revelation 15:2, "And I saw something like a sea of glass mingled with fire. And those who have victory over the beast, over his image, over his mark, and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass," that's heaven, "having harps of God." So it says that these people who got the victory over the beast and over his mark, they are the ones that stand on that sea of glass having the harps of God. So it's important, friends, that you know who the beast is. And it's important that you get victory over it. That is what it says in Revelation 20, verse 4. "And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads or their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. We're going to talk about that 1,000 years in a subsequent night. But friends, it becomes important that you and I are among those people who receive the seal of God and have the privilege of standing on the sea of glass among those who will live and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. And those who receive the mark of the beast, what about them? Listen to Revelation 16:2. "So the first went and poured out his bowl upon the earth." That's the angel that had the seven last plagues. That's what it's talking about here. "And a foul and loathsome sore came upon the men who had the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image." You see, those who worship the beast, they're going to get a very, very bad, loathsome sore. The scripture says it is terrible. It's painful. Revelation 16:11 says, "Then the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and from his kingdom became full of darkness. And they gnawed their tongues because of the pain." Pain from what? Because they had blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pain and their sores, and they did not repent of their deeds. So the scripture says that it will be painful enough that they will gnaw their tongues. So what am I trying to tell us tonight is that there's clearly two classes of people. Those that receive the mark of the beast, those that receive the seal of God. And so, with that, let's begin to take a look. Let's ask ourselves, what is the mark of the beast? Those of you in Bucharest, Romania, and all the rest at the downlink sites, you ready to go on? Remember, we're talking about an institution, not about good, solid Christians of all faiths, including the Roman Catholic Church. All right, let's go. Well, there are some things that we need to establish that the mark of the beast is not what it isn't. One, the mark of the beast is not the beast. Okay, that makes sense. Clear on that? The mark is something that the beast gives. You can't take the beast and say it's the mark. No, the mark is something that the beast gives. Also, it tells us in Revelation 13:18, here is the wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is a number of a man, and his number is 666. Now, God gives us that number to help us identify that beast, who it is. That number is a symbol. You have to understand, the beast is symbolic, right? There are no beasts running around with 7 heads and 10 horns. It's symbolic. And the image is symbolic. And the name is symbolic. And the number is symbolic. And the seal that we are going to talk about tonight is symbolic. That mark is symbolic. These are symbolic languages that God uses that you and I must understand what he's talking about. And so he says that the mark is received on the forehead or in the hand, and it's symbolic. You understanding this? There's not anybody that's going to come around, folks, and brand you with a burning iron. That's not going to happen. They are not going to come around with some laser gun and write something across your forehead or on your right hand. That won't happen, friends. Now, let me ask you something. Let's say that someone did hold me down, and he took a laser and wrote something across my forehead. Would that change my relationship to God? No, of course not. When the scripture uses that, it is talking about symbolism. Why does it talk about the forehead? Let's think. Because that is the seat of our intelligence. That's where I make decisions. That's where I give mental acceptance to something or someone. And that's where I say, I believe that. That's what I believe. That's why it's placed in the forehead. And why is it placed on the hand? It's placed in the hand because the right hand in Scripture represents cooperation. And I say, well, I may not believe that, but I'll go along with it. Because everybody's doing it. The majority's doing it. I'll cooperate. And therefore, you'll get that mark in your right hand, even if you don't believe it, or in your forehead, if you do. And so you notice that the seal of God was not placed on the hand. You see, the devil will take you any way he can get you, believer or not, as long as you follow him. But God wants you to believe intelligently, choosing him. And he wants you to follow him as well. And so that number is symbolic. That's what it represents. So now, what is the mark of the beast? I'm going to read to you 3 scriptures. And when I'm through reading those 3 scriptures, I'm going to ask you a question. Now, the question isn't hard. I'm not going to ask you any trick question. Just listen carefully to what it says. Clay, Cluj, Romania, and all the others out there in Romania watching, Revelation 14:9-11. Then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast in his image and receives his mark on his forehead or in his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full of strength into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest, day or night, who worship the beast in his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. Now, those three verses that I just read to you, are they talking about people that receive the mark of the beast? Let's look at it. Then a third angel followed him, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast in his image, receives his mark on his forehead or his hand, is that talking about people who receive the mark of the beast? Okay. He turned, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full of strength into the cup of his indignation, it says. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels, in the presence of the Lamb. Is that talking about people who receive the mark of the beast? Right? Goes on, and the smoke of their torment ascends forever, and they have no rest or night, who worship the beast in his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. Is that talking about people who receive the mark of the beast? Yes. Those three verses are talking about people who receive the mark of the beast. That is verse 9 and 10 and 11 of Revelation 14. I'm going to read you verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Now, do these people receive the mark of the beast? No. Why don't they? They don't receive the mark of the beast. Why? Because they keep the commandments of God and they have the faith of Jesus. Make that clear. If I keep God's commandments and I have faith in Jesus, I don't receive the mark of the beast. Then the mark of the beast must have something to do with the commandments of God and that faith in Jesus Christ. Friends, are you following me so far? Now, I mean, the scripture is very clear on this. It affects God's commandments, and it affects faith in Jesus Christ. And like all of these presentations that we've had so far, we come right back to our relationship with Jesus Christ and what the Bible has to say. And so the mark of the beast affects those two things. It affects the commandments of God, and it affects our faith in Jesus Christ. Now the question we have to ask ourselves tonight is, has this beast power done anything that affects the commandments of God? And secondly, our faith in Jesus Christ. Let's see. Let me read to you a statement from the Council of Trent. It's a matter of history. This is the council that was held to define Roman Catholic doctrine. This is what it says, and I quote, if anyone shall say that by faith alone the sinner is justified, so as to understand that nothing else is required to cooperate in the attainment of the grace of justification, and that it is in no way necessary that he be prepared and disposed of the action of his own will, let him be anathema, excommunicated, cast out. Right here, I should stop and just say again, we are not in any way attacking individuals, our friends in the Roman Catholic faith. There are many, many conscientious Catholics, and we love them. We're talking about a system that the Bible describes. You understand what that is saying? It says that if you believe you can be justified by faith alone, then you are to be lost. That's what the statement says, folks. It definitely affects faith in Jesus Christ. That's what the whole Reformation was about. That's what Martin Luther stood for, by faith alone in Jesus Christ. And this statement radically contrasts that. It tells you that you cannot be saved by faith alone, that you have to be saved by faith and works. And that is the church's position, official position. Let me read you one more, and I quote, "There is only one holy and Catholic and apostolic church, outside of which there is no salvation, for every creature to be subject to the Roman pontiff," stated officially by Pope Boniface VIII. It says that if you're going to be saved, you have to be subject to that church. Now I want to share with you what the scripture says about faith. Romans 1:17, this is what it says, "For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." That's what Martin Luther built his whole platform on. And it didn't say a word in there, dear friends, that you and I are saved any other way but by faith in Jesus. Faith in what the Lord Jesus Christ did for you and for me. Romans 3:28 goes on and it says, "Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith apart from the deeds of the law." We talked about that so clearly last night. We talked about that last week. The law will not save you. It is only through faith in Jesus Christ that you and I can be made whole. Hebrews 11:6 goes on, "But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him." So I'm telling you tonight that the Bible teaches that you are saved by faith and faith alone. It definitely has done something. This system, this belief, this doctrine that we're talking about has done something to affect the faith in Jesus Christ. So then what about the other side? What about the commandments of God? Has that power done anything that affects the commandments of God? We touched on this the other evening too. Let's look at it again. Jesus said in John 14:15, "If you love me, keep my commandments." John 14:21, "He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." You say, "I love you, Lord." And he says, "Then keep my commandments. Follow me. Walk with me." 1 John 5:3 puts it this way, "For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome." Now, friends, I'm going to read you a very startling statement. It has been confirmed personally by a Catholic priest. He was talked to on the phone and asked if this statement was in fact true. And he validated that he wrote it, and he confirmed that indeed it was true, and furthermore, the Catholic Church stood behind him in that statement. This is what the Catholic priest wrote. Quote, "Perhaps the boldest thing, the most revolutionary change the church that ever did happen in the first century, the holy day, the Sabbath, was changed from Saturday to Sunday. Not from any directions noted in the scriptures, but from the church's sense of its own power. People who think that the scriptures should be the sole authority should logically become Seventh-day Adventists and keep Saturday holy." End of quote. St. Catherine Catholic Church Sentinel, 1995. That Catholic priest is telling you, friends, in his own words, that if you're going to go by this book that we've been talking about so much each night, and you are going to build your faith on God's holy word and on that word of God alone, then you need to keep the Sabbath holy, the seventh day Sabbath holy. That's what he's saying. Let me read you a couple of other statements from the same church body. "The church, on the other hand, after changing the day of rest from the Jewish Sabbath, or the seventh day of the week, to the first day, made the third commandment refer to Sunday as the Lord's Day." This is no secret. That's right in the Catholic Encyclopedia. If you pick up a Catholic catechism, you will not find the Sabbath to be the fourth commandment. You will find it to be the third commandment, because they took the second one out. And they took the tenth one and divided it. So they still have ten commandments. Of course, and I quote, "The Catholic Church claims that the change was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical, or her church power and authority in religious matters." Goes on, "Sunday is our mark of authority. The church, listen friends, the church is above the Bible. And this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact." From the Catholic record. Now I told you the other night that you have to understand where your authority rests. You see, as far as I'm concerned, the church is subject to the Bible. The Bible is not subject to the church. But it said there, in that Catholic statement, that the church is above the Bible. And this transference of the Sabbath observance, it said, is proof of that fact. Now, if you want to say that the church is above the Bible, then you have grounds for saying that this is the day of worship. But if you're going to stand on Scripture and Scripture alone, then you have to take a different stand, friends. Now, the good news is that no one currently has the mark of the beast. No one now has received that mark, because the Bible says it has to be enforced. That means it has to be legislated. Just because a person goes to church on the first day of the week does not mean that they have the mark of the beast. Do you understand me there in Kanu, North Nigeria? The Scripture tells us it has to be enforced. Revelation 13, 16 and 17 says, "He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or in their foreheads, that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark, name of the beast, or the number of his name." That means it has to be enforced on the people. That means there has to be legislation. Goes on and says, he was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause. Speak means legislation, and cause means to enforce. So Revelation 13:15 says, as many as would not worship the image of the beast, to be killed. So it says that it will be enforced by government legislation. So you're saying, Dr. Patzer, could that ever happen? How about in your country, in America? And if it could happen in America, could it happen in other countries where I live? Let me answer your question. I'm going to read you a few relatively recent statements from our country. Here's one. The civil authorities should be urged to cooperate with the church in maintaining and strengthening this public worship of God, and to support with their own authority the regulations set down by the church's pastor. For it is only in this way that the faithful will understand why it is that Sunday and not the Sabbath day that we keep holy. From the Roman Catholic Catechism, 1985. That's what's going on today, folks, in my country. Not hundreds of years ago. They are saying this needs to be enforced by my government now. Listen to this. Massachusetts Council of Churches, back in Boston, January 1993, 8 years ago, issued a paper entitled Sunday Closing Laws Revisited, a biblical, ethical, and sociological study of a common day of rest. And they gave it to the government officials and said that it needed to be enforced upon the people today. In respecting religious liberty, it said, and the common good of all, remember we talked about the majority last night, all Christians should seek recognition of Sundays as the church's holy days, as legal holidays. It is time that we demonstrate our Catholic vitality and engage in public policy debate. We have the power and the people to embark on this movement, a movement that will ultimately benefit all Americans. Wow, quite frankly, if you live in America and aren't a Catholic, that should be pretty scary to you. It is to me, and it's certainly not true. But they are going to enforce upon people the day that they worship, and that is not for the good of all Americans, or Indians, or Asians, or Latin Americans, or Africans, or Europeans, or Russians. Friends, all I am trying to get across to you tonight is that those movements are taking place as we speak. Not sometime distant, not sometime way past, but they are happening right now. Those who do not receive the mark of the beast will not be able to buy or sell. Revelation 13:17 says, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name. Now, friends, it is serious when a person can no longer buy or sell. That's a basic right. And as long as they have money, they still can. It's always been true. If you have money, you can buy something. Because if you can't buy it at the front of the store, you can usually buy it at the back of the store. There has always been a gray market and a black market. And some of you know more about this than I do. You just can't stop people from buying if they have money. But today they are making tremendous moves in the world concerning the finances of nations. As this paper says, One Money for Europe. That was a headline. But there are greater moves being taking place in this area, and that's referred to as electronic money. You're familiar with this, where you have what is called a smart card, or over in Bulawayo, where they call it a link card. You don't need money. All you need is the card. Your entire bank account can be put in that card. It's called a debit card in America. All you have to do is go to a store, supermarket, go through the checkout counter, slide your card, and the amount is automatically taken from your bank account. Now, there's some good things to this. It has tremendous possibilities because we spend millions and billions of dollars in money transactions today. It would save significant amounts of money to go to that system. But secondly, it would be a great thing as far as helping the problem of stealing and counterfeit money. But friends, the moment it gets to that point, the downside is that the government can also stop you from buying. Because all the government would have to do is say, don't take that number. Don't accept that number. And your account is closed. Now let me make it clear, I'm no prophet. I don't know how it's going to happen. I certainly can't predict what's going to take place precisely. What I am saying is I can now at least see how it's possible, and I will believe it'll happen because the Bible says it so. Revelation 13:18, it says, here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is a number of a man. His number is 666. Well, what is that number? The Bible uses two numbers throughout Revelation. The number 7 represents perfection or completeness. The number 6 represents imperfection. His number is 666. What do you have? The beast represents a false religious system with human authority for the authority of Christ. And the church is above the Bible. That's what they're teaching. Human authority above Christ's authority. Man's transition for God's word. Substitute the civil law for the commandments of God. A counterfeit Sabbath for the true Sabbath. All of those things are put in there in place of it. That's why it speaks of the number 666. It represents a counterfeit system. Believers in the last days, look at what it says about them. Revelation 13 says, he who leads into captivity shall go into captivity, and he who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. And then it says, here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Revelation 14:12 is a very significant statement. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. You see, God is looking today for men and women, people, who are willing to follow the Lord Jesus Christ and what he says, who are willing to walk with him, willing to follow what he says, willing to keep God's commandments. He who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments, the Bible says, is a liar. And the truth, it goes on, is not in him. That's not what Dr. Patzer says. That's what the scripture says. You may say, well, I know the Lord. I love him. But the person who says that and does not keep the commandments is, according to the Bible, a liar. 1 John 2:4-6 says this, he who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. How did Jesus walk in John 8:29? And he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that please him. What is it that pleases him? Very clear. It says in Acts 5:29, then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. We ought to obey God rather than men. Friends, tonight, there's a very clear distinction in what the Bible has been talking to us about. The mark of the beast or the seal of God? This may be brand new to you tonight, but just because you haven't heard it before does not mean it's not important. It is eternally, forever important. Tonight, we're going to make a call for those who have seen some new truth and want to act upon it, because God is calling you tonight to make a decision as to whether you're going to receive the mark of the beast or the seal of God that we talked about last night. Think about it while the men sing. Before the men sing another stanza of that great classic song about surrendering all, I want to give you the opportunity in the last few minutes before we sign off for tonight to accept the message that God has spoken to your heart tonight. It is an incredibly significant message that means all the difference between life and death, eternal life and death. And if last night when we talked about that beautiful message of faith in Jesus struck home to your heart and conscience, and tonight if the message about the mark of the beast also struck home to your heart and conscience, I want to invite you to stand to your feet right now. Maybe you've understood it forever, as long as you can remember, or maybe it's the first time. But if that message made sense to you tonight, I want you to stand to your feet right now. First time, or after many times that you have heard this message, but you want to say, yes, that makes sense, then stand to your feet. But if this is a new message to you tonight, if it is the first time that that conscious realization that we're in an incredible struggle, an incredible war, has come to your consciousness and your heart, then I want to invite you tonight to make a decision. And I want you to demonstrate that decision by coming right down here to the front. This is a big stadium, and it takes a long time for you to come, so I want you to come right now. We will wait for you. Many have done it, hundreds and hundreds have done it other nights so far in this series. Tonight, I want to invite you to come right down here with the other leaders that will meet you, because we want to have a special prayer for you. And those of you in our hundreds and hundreds of downlink sites around the world, I want you to stand to your feet and come to the forward, to the front, because there will be a leader that will be there, a spiritual guardian that will stand there with you and pray with you. Don't hesitate. This is the most important decision you will make of your life. And the devil will try everything to keep you from coming forward, either here in this large stadium or there at a downlink site. God has spoken to your heart last night and tonight, and I invite you to come forward and make a public declaration of the fact that you want to be on the side of Jesus Christ and His holy word. Come forward right now. We will wait for you. Those of you in the downlink sites, come forward to the front of that site while the men sing another verse.
All to Jesus I surrender now. I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of full salvation. Glory,
this is the
glory,
first time commitment tonight, the first time you have seen this message, and you say, yes, it's true, then I want you to come down forward. Yes, bless your hearts. Hundreds are beginning to come again. Come down to the front. Meet our spiritual leaders. Come right on across. Come right on across. Come across. Those of you from the side, come on right down to the middle. Those of you that are making a first-time commitment to this message that we heard last night of righteousness by faith, and tonight, the opposite side of receiving the mark of the beast. That's the choice. It's right there. Choice of accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior, having faith in Him. That's the only way, as we talked about last night, that you can be saved, as opposed to doing it your own way or following an institution that has another idea. Keep coming. Bless your hearts. First time decision to accept Jesus Christ. And now in the last moment before the men sing again, the last moment before our satellites tune out, I want to make a special appeal to those of you there. You're listening. It may be more difficult because you may be in a home. You may be watching from a site that has this televised on the side and broadcast on the side of a church. Maybe in a bigger area, wherever you are right now. Even if you're with friends or if you're with strangers, come forward. There'll be someone to meet you. And most important, Jesus will be there to welcome you home. Friend, this is your night of decision. This is the night that you have been destined to make a decision for eternity forever. Come forward. Those of you in the stadium are coming, still coming. Bless your hearts. Many, many, many. And those of you out there, be sure you come forward as well. And before we sign off, tomorrow night's topic, when the trumpet sounds, talking about what happens when we die. We will see you.